Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blazing Saddles Meets Young Frankenstein, the 50th anniversary of the year of Mel Brooks, by Bruce G. Hallenbeck. Narrated by Peter Berkrot. Introduction, 1974. They don't make years like 1974 anymore. Pop culture was exploring themes that had never been allowed to be depicted before, thanks to the relaxed censorship of the times. Television shows such as All in the Family pushed the boundaries of what sitcoms, and the medium itself, could be. Made-for-television movies such as The Autobiography of Miss Jane Pittman proved that television could be just as socially relevant as theatrical films. And another TV movie, Born Innocent, starring Linda Blair of The Exorcist fame, proved that television could be just as shocking as theatrical films in its depiction of a gang rape by other girls of Blair's character, in which the rapists used a plunger handle. It was a time of controversial, thought-provoking, and envelope-pushing subject matter in every medium, and Born Innocent became the highest-rated TV movie of the year. Perhaps to counter this trend, Billboard's top two songs of the year were the schmaltzy The Way We Were, warbled by Barbara Streisand, from the hit movie of the same name, and the even schmaltzier Seasons in the Sun by Terry Jack. The biggest pop star of the year, though, was probably Elton John, whose album Goodbye Yellow Brick Road became something of a cultural phenomenon. In the fashion world, leisure suits were introduced, and elegance took a nosedive. In literature, the first book by an author named Stephen King was published. It was called Carrie, and it made King, who wrote the book when he was living in a trailer, into an overnight success. Another book, All the President's Men by Carl Bernstein and Bob Woodward, reflected the year's largest scandal, Watergate, which culminated in the resignation of President Richard M. Nixon on August 8, 1974. My personal fondness for that year is perhaps better understood when you consider the fact that it was the year I lost my virginity, in the backseat of a Chevy, no less, with my first love. There was another rite of passage that year, though, not just for me, but for a lot of other people my age. Going to see a little film called Blazing Saddles, directed by Mel Brooks. Released on February 7th of that year, Brooks's uproarious parody became an instant cultural touchstone. Blazing Saddles could not have been made even a few years previously, as censorship of the time would not have allowed it. After the creation of the American movie rating system in 1968, subjects that would have been taboo a few years earlier were finally allowed to be portrayed on screen. Blazing Saddles tackled racism and prostitution, among other topics. But most of all, it was a parody of classic Hollywood westerns, produced in R-rated form that caused audiences of the time to laugh uproariously, in spite of, or because of, its politically incorrect and sometimes downright offensive jokes. As times have changed again since 1974, it probably wouldn't be produced today. Later in 1974, and just in time for Christmas, Brooks's Young Frankenstein was released. Another triumph for the filmmaker, both critically and commercially, Young Frankenstein quickly became another neoclassic, filmed in glorious black and white to recreate the look of the old Universal Pictures horror films, of which it was an affectionate parody. While not as groundbreaking as Blazing Saddles, which, among other things, broke the cinematic fart barrier, it continued in the tradition of Brooks's previous film, in that it changed the face of movie parodies, and of horror films as well, as it turned out. Young Frankenstein was the second in a comedic 1-2 punch from Brooks in less than a year, a rarity in motion picture history for any director. This book will attempt to put these two beloved classics into historical perspective, in the context of an era when breaking down barriers and societal taboos was becoming the norm in pop culture. The journey from All in the Family, which made fun of racists, to Blazing Saddles, which did the same, was not much of a trek. Similarly, Andy Warhol's Frankenstein, a.k.a. Flesh for Frankenstein, released a few months earlier than Young Frankenstein, paved the way for Brooks's more refined take on the same subject. There were many more influences in between, however, many of them forgotten today. While Brooks's two classic parodies are still being talked about in the 21st century, and are widely regarded as his two best films. One thing is for certain. Blazing Saddles could only have been made in the freewheeling, anything-goes decade of the 1970s, an era when hardcore porn could be shown in a mainstream theater, and political correctness was years in the future. Young Frankenstein's slightly gentler humor is still very much of its time, and while a similar film could be made today, the fact is, it's a spoof that has never been bettered. Let's return, then, to that madcap year when hair was long on boys and girls. Bell-bottoms were still popular. Nixon was out and Gerald Ford was in. And Mel Brooks and his laugh machine reigned supreme at the venue that was just beginning to blossom. The Multiplex. Bruce G. Hallenbeck. January 2024. Part 1. Blazing Saddles. 1. The 1970s. Anything goes. On June 12, 1972, a little film called Deep Throat premiered at the World Theater in New York City. The movie quickly went on to make a record, for the time, $3 million in its first 6 weeks of release, leading it to be referred to as the Ben-Hur of porn flicks, and it became a sensation that helped to launch a middle-class, all-American interest in porn films that came to be called porno chic. For the first time ever, Americans went to mainstream theaters in droves to see hardcore films that featured explicit sex. This was no longer just the raincoat crowd, but rather young couples, older folks, and pretty much anyone who could get into the theater to see X-rated films. This trend did not arise out of a vacuum. It had been gestating for a while. American and international films had been doing a slow striptease ever since the post-war era. But in the United States in particular, since 1952, when the U.S. Supreme Court declared film to be protected speech under the First Amendment, in a case that had to do with the screening in New York State of the Italian film The Miracle, a short directed by Roberto Rossellini. The film, which was one half of an anthology movie called L'Amour, had been controversial in its depiction of a peasant girl who slept with a man she took to be Saint Joseph and ended up bearing his child. The National Legion of Decency and various Catholic organizations declared it to be blasphemy, but the court recognized the artistry of the film, which had been previously released in Italy, one of the most Catholic countries in the world, without incident, and declared it, and by extension, films in general, to be artistic expression that was protected by the First Amendment. This opened the floodgates for foreign films containing subject matter that had long been banned under the U.S. Production Code to be released in America en masse. The post-war years in America saw a gradual liberalization of culture in general, which ultimately led to the abandonment of the Production Code in 1968. The code was replaced with a rating system that consisted of four types of cinema: G for general audiences, M, later PG, for more mature viewers, R, restricted to those over 16 unless accompanied by an adult, and X, for those over 16 only. Now, formerly taboo subjects such as prostitution, homosexuality, abortion, and other adult topics could be fully explored on screen, with full frontal nude scenes and the utterance of four-letter words as well. The other arts were also becoming liberated, with Broadway shows such as Hair and off-Broadway revues such as O Calcutta, featuring nudity and strong language galore. The 1960s, after all, had been a time of revolution and challenges to societal norms, with Americans protesting the Vietnam War, women protesting for their own civil rights, and African Americans working hard to achieve theirs. The arts reflected these mercurial social changes as barriers were being broken down in every area of culture, not just in the United States, but all over the free world. Although television was still considered to be a family medium, at least in the United States, and therefore nudity and strong language were still forbidden, TV stretched the boundaries and pushed the envelope as much as possible. Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In, a wild sketch comedy series that started its run in 1968 and was hosted by comedians Dan Rowan and Dick Martin, became a cultural phenomenon for its poking fun at politics, its slightly off-color and off-kilter humor, and its ensemble cast of future stars, including Goldie Hawn, Lily Tomlin, and Richard Dawson. All in the Family, an American sitcom debuting in 1971, was another breakthrough in its depiction of the life of a so-called lovable bigot named Archie Bunker, played to the hilt by Carol O'Connor. Based on the British series, Till Death Do Us Part, the American version featured episodes centered around racism, infidelity, rape, homosexuality, and many other topics that were being explored on U.S. television for the first time. American audiences were also amused by another first on All in the Family. The sound of a flushing toilet could be heard in the background in one scene of the first episode. This rudeness was accepted by sitcom audiences for the first time as a part of daily life that simply added to the realism of the televised life at the Bunker's house. And it was a foreshadowing of rudeness to come in both comedies and dramas, on television and in movie theaters. It was in this cultural stew of the early 70s that comic, writer, and more recently, film director Mel Brooks decided to make his wildest film yet. Brooks, born on a tenement kitchen table as Melvin James Kaminsky in Brooklyn on June 28, 1926, came from a family of Jews from Kyiv, in what is now Ukraine. He had three older brothers, Lenny, Bernie, and Irving. His father, Max, passed away of tuberculosis at the age of 34. Brooks was only 2 years old at the time. Brooks said in later years that he felt that his father's early death was responsible for what he called his anger and hostility, on which he based much of his comedy. Brooks was a rather small child who had a tendency to be somewhat sickly, and he was bullied by other boys because of his size. Growing up in a tenement in the Brooklyn neighborhood of Williamsburg, Brooks had something of an epiphany when his Uncle Joe took him to see the Broadway musical Anything Goes, starring Ethel Merman, at the Alvin Theater on West 52nd Street. Upon seeing the show, he informed his uncle that he wasn't going to work in the garment district like everyone else. He was going into show business. Sure enough, when he was only 14, he got a job as a poolside entertainer in the summer resort area known as the Borscht Belt, located in the Catskill Mountains of upstate New York. At the hotel where he was performing, entertaining the guests around the pool by jumping into it with his clothes on and other wild physical comedy, he met an 18-year-old named Isaac Sid Caesar, who played in a dance band and performed comedy 3 times a week. They became fast friends. That same year, Brooks was also introduced to drummer and bandleader Buddy Rich, who taught him how to play the drums. Brooks started to earn money as a musician and ultimately got into performing stand-up comedy professionally when he was 16 and had to step in at the last minute for an ailing MC. It was around this time that Melvin James Kaminsky changed his professional name to Mel Brooks, taking his new surname from his mother's maiden name of Brookman. After graduating high school in 1944, Brooks was drafted into the army and was sent to France and Belgium during World War II, ultimately participating in the Battle of the Bulge, the last major German offensive campaign on the Western Front during the war. After the war ended in Europe, Brooks joined the Special Services as a comic, where he toured army bases and was eventually put in charge of entertainment at Wiesbaden. In 1946, having attained the rank of corporal, Brooks was honorably discharged from the army. Back home, Brooks's mother had gotten him a job at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, but the budding comic wanted no part of that. Instead, he headed back to the Catskills, where he worked as a stand-up comic and began doing summer stock and radio work as well. When he was 24, his old pal Sid Caesar offered him money to write gags for him, and Brooks became a full-time comedy writer. He broke into the new medium of television, the wave of the future, with the help of Caesar, who hired him to write jokes for the Dumont NBC series, The Admiral Broadway Review, in 1949. Brooks received the princely salary of $50 a week, off the books. In 1950, Caesar created Your Show of Shows, a live 90-minute variety show with an accent on comedy, for which he hired Brooks as one of the writers. The other writers included such future comedy greats as Carl Reiner, Neil Simon, and Mel Tolkien. Sid Caesar's variety series, Your Show of Shows, ran from 1950 through 1954. His fellow writers on that series were Woody Allen, Neil Simon, Larry Gelbart, and Carl Reiner. Your Show of Shows was a huge success, only ending when co-star Imogene Coca left the series to host her own series, The Imogene Coca Show, which ended up running for only 1 year. Meanwhile, Caesar countered with Caesar's Hour, retaining most of his Your Show of Show writers, including Brooks. Caesar's Hour ran from 1954 to 1957, and during the run, Brooks and Carl Reiner became close friends and worked out a few comic gags of their own. With Reiner, Brooks played the comic character, the 2,000-year-old man, in which Reiner interviewed Brooks's character for a series of comedy routines that were released on record and performed frequently on television. By the late 1950s, the frequently satirical act gained many admirers in New York City, including critic Kenneth Tynan, who called Brooks the most original comic improviser I had ever seen. Brooks turned his talents to Broadway in the early 1960s, when he wrote the music and lyrics to the show All American, which debuted in 1962. Starring Ray Bolger, it ran for 80 performances and was nominated for 2 Tony Awards. In 1963, Brooks conceived of an animated short comedy film called The Critic, a satire of so-called art films. Directed by Ernest Pintoff, it won the Academy Award for Best Animated Short Film. At this point, Brooks went from strength to strength, combining talents with comedy writer Buck Henry to create Get Smart, a TV series about a bumbling spy, as a parodic answer to the spy craze that had currently taken over the pop culture landscape, a result of the huge success of the James Bond series that had begun with Dr. No, 1962, and hit its peak with Goldfinger, 1964. The Bond movies had made a star out of Sean Connery, and Get Smart did the same thing for former stand-up comic Don Adams. Beginning in 1965, Get Smart was a huge success on NBC, and its zany, anarchic humor was tremendously influential, setting the stage for such wild series as Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In, which began 3 years later. Get Smart ran for 5 years and won 7 Emmy Awards. This all led to Brooks becoming a film director in 1967 with The Producers, a brazen satire of Broadway musicals that included the hilarious but controversial song Springtime for Hitler. The genesis for the film went all the way back to All American, when a reporter asked Brooks what he was going to do next, and he quipped, Springtime for Hitler, the title of which may have been a spoof on Springtime for Henry, a comedy play that had scored an 8-month run on Broadway in the early 1930s. For several years, Brooks had considered a rather bold idea of writing a musical comedy that had something to do with Adolf Hitler. Eventually, he found 2 brave producers, Joseph E. Levine and Sidney Glaser, and he ended up directing what came to be known as The Producers. Starring Zero Mostel and Gene Wilder, the film became an underground hit and won Best Original Screenplay for Brooks at the 41st Annual Academy Awards. Brooks's next feature, The 12 Chairs, 1970, didn't fare so well, Loosely based on a Russian novel, the movie starred Ron Moody, Frank Langella, and Dom DeLuise, and was filmed in Yugoslavia on a budget of $1.5 million. The comic story concerned three men in search of a set of 12 chairs that contained a fortune in diamonds. Despite the excellent cast, the film didn't do so well with either the critics or the public, and for a short time, Brooks felt that his newly launched career as a film director was already over. Several things conspired to make his next film a big hit, however. In 1972, Brooks met agent David Begelman, who helped to set up a deal with him at Warner Brothers, in which he would be hired as a script doctor for an unproduced comedy western called Tex X. Brooks was ultimately hired as director for the project, which would become one of the most successful comedy movies of all time. The screenplay for Tex X, written by Andrew Bergman, was a parody of the western genre. The title was a reference to 1960s black Muslim leader Malcolm X, as it concerned a black sheriff in the Old West. Begelman told Brooks that it was perfect for him, and Brooks got together with Bergman, lawyer Norman Steinberg, dentist Alan Uger, and one other writer, comic Richard Pryor, to create what would eventually become Blazing Saddles, which not only spoofed westerns, but to a certain extent, made fun of so-called blaxploitation films. The trend in the early 70s toward movies and television shows to explore previously untouched topics had led to a spate of films referred to as blaxploitation. An ethnic subgenre of the action exploitation film, blaxploitation coincided with the surge of social and political interest in race relations in the 60s and 70s, and the films were aimed at urban African-American audiences, although the trend eventually expanded across racial and ethnic boundaries. Such films as Cotton Comes to Harlem, 1970, Shaft, 1971, and Blackula, 1972, were essentially African-American versions of tried-and-true Hollywood genres, such as the detective film and the horror movie, but set in updated urban environments and featuring soul and funk music on the soundtrack. Elements of blaxploitation eventually spilled over into other genres. The first James Bond movie to star Roger Moore, Live and Let Die, 1973, was partially set in the Harlem underworld, as well as in the voodoo cults of the West Indies. The martial arts movie Enter the Dragon paired Bruce Lee with black actor Jim Kelly in that same year. This was not a time of what we would now call political correctness. Some blaxploitation films had titles that couldn't even be hinted at today. Movies such as The Legend of N-R Charlie, 1972, and Boss N-R, 1975, pushed the envelope of what was acceptable even at that time. Can you imagine a theater marquee with the N-word emblazoned across it in the 21st century? Interestingly enough, both of those films were blaxploitation versions of that most classic of Hollywood genres, the Western. Tex X was also a Western, albeit a comic one with a difference. As Brooks wrote in his autobiography, All About Me, My Remarkable Life in Show Business, the script was, in fact, crazy. The dialogue was 1974, and the setting was 1874. Since this story was about a black sheriff in a white Western town, I knew I needed Richard Pryor to be one of the writers. He was a friend and a brilliant comedian who hadn't really broken out yet. Brooks and his compatriots were about to create one of the most laugh-out-loud, outrageous, and politically incorrect comedies ever made. 2. Please do not write a polite script. Born to a Jewish family in Queens, New York, in 1945, Andrew Bergman graduated from Binghamton University when he was 20. And attained his Ph.D. in American History from the University of Wisconsin-Madison in 1970. The following year, Bergman published his first book, We're in the Money, Depression America and Its Films, at NYU Press. The book took a detailed look at American films of the 1930s, and of how they helped keep alive the truths and myths of American society through one of its darkest periods in history. Bergman's writing style, which one critic noted, makes history fun, ensured that the book was well received, and the author returned with another book about classic American movies, James Cagney, The Pictorial Treasury of Film Stars, published by Galahad Press early in 1974. In between the writing of those books, however, Bergman broke into the film business by writing an original script called Tex X. Originally a novella about a black sheriff in the Old West, he sold the idea to Warner Brothers, and the studio asked him to turn it into a screenplay. The rest may be history, but it's a long and convoluted one. The history shifted into high gear when Brooks got involved. It all came about as a result of Brooks meeting with David Begelman, a successful talent agent who had just joined forces with Freddie Fields, another successful talent agent, to form Creative Management Associates, CMA, which represented Brooks. As Brooks wrote in his autobiography, at this time in his career he had 2 Oscars and plenty of critical acclaim, but he had only earned $50,000 apiece for the producers and the 12 chairs, and he was wondering if he would be able to make a living making films. Begelman was a fan of Brooks's work, and one day in 1973, he happened to bump into him on 57th Street in New York. Begelman asked Brooks to join him for lunch. It turned out to be a fateful meeting. As Brooks wrote in his memoirs, "I knew he would take me to a good place for lunch because he dressed well, drove a Rolls Royce, and generally lived in style." Begelman took Brooks to the dining room of the Sherry Netherlands Hotel, and over lunch, pointed out to Brooks that he had just placed a call to him that hadn't been returned. Brooks said he would probably receive the call when he got home, and asked Begelman what it was about. Begelman said, "It's about a rough draft of a movie that I just read. It's a movie you were born to make." The agent went on to tell him that the script was zany, all over the place, and that there was some wonderful stuff in it. Brooks pointed out that he always wrote and directed his own work, and that he wasn't really for hire. Begelman was insistent, however. He went on to say that this project could be very commercial, and that he could probably get Brooks $100,000 to rewrite and direct it. As Brooks was not at the top of his game financially at that time, he told Begelman he might rethink things. He might be for hire after all. Begelman took Brooks back to his office at CMA and handed him the rough draft of the Tex X screenplay. He asked him to take it to the next office to read it, come back, and they would discuss it. As it turned out, Brooks was enchanted by the script. As he put it, the dialogue was 1974 and the setting was 1874. It was right up my alley. I knew it was the beginning of something that could be very, very good. Brooks told Begelman that he wanted to rework the script with a group of comedy writers, because that was the way he was used to working on the Sid Caesar shows. Begelman agreed and hired him to write and direct Tex X on the spot. Brooks wanted to retain Bergman, as he didn't want to drop the writer who came up with the idea, feeling that he could continue to be very important to the screenplay. After hiring Bergman for the rewrite, Brooks went directly to his friend Richard Pryor. He felt that Pryor was not only the best stand-up comic who ever lived, but that he was the perfect writer for this movie, because his comedy came from the humanity that he had experienced. In the early 70s, Pryor was just about to break through to mainstream audiences. Born in Peoria, Illinois in 1940, Pryor had grown up in a brothel run by his grandmother, where his alcoholic mother worked as a prostitute. His father was a former boxer, hustler, and pimp. Pryor's mother had abandoned him when he was 10 years old, leaving him to be raised by his violent, abusive grandmother. He was one of 4 children raised in the brothel, and he was sexually abused when he was 7 years old. The unusual circumstances of Pryor's upbringing, which included frequent beatings by his grandmother, caused him to act out in school, and he was expelled at age 14. Pryor joined the Army in 1958, where he served until 1960. Stationed in West Germany, he continued his tendency toward volatility and was briefly jailed there for an incident in which he and several other black soldiers beat and stabbed although not fatally, a white soldier for laughing at the racially charged scenes in the film Imitation of Life, in which director Douglas Sirk examined the issues of class, race, and gender. In 1963, determined to make a name for himself that wouldn't be published only in the police blotter, Pryor moved to New York City and began performing in clubs, alongside such performers as Nina Simone, Woody Allen, and Bob Dylan. Inspired by the success of rising African-American comic Bill Cosby, Pryor began his career in comedy as a mainstream act, eschewing any real controversy at first. He appeared on such middle-brow all-American television shows as The Ed Sullivan Show, The Tonight Show, and The Merv Griffin Show, leading to a successful stint in Las Vegas. His wordplay and hilarious stories led to a steady, if unspectacular, early career, in which he even did some acting on TV series such as The Wild Wild West. In 1967, eager to spice up his act, he sensed the zeitgeist of the times and started adding profanity to his wordplay, often using the verboten N-word in reference to himself. 2 years later, he moved to Berkeley, California, where he became immersed in the counterculture, explored his bisexuality. He once allegedly had an affair with Marlon Brando, among others, and started writing for television series such as Sanford and Son, and a special starring Lily Tomlin for which he shared an Emmy Award. He also expanded his acting resume in such films as Lady Sings the Blues, 1972, and The Mac, 1973. He already had two comedy albums to his credit at the independent label Laugh Records when he released his breakthrough album, That N-R's Crazy, in 1974. It was a commercial and critical hit, winning the Grammy Award for Best Comedy Album in 1975. When Brooks contacted him to work on Tex X, Pryor was on the cusp of stardom. He was also, unfortunately, prey to a pretty expensive cocaine habit, among other forms of substance abuse. Brooks noted years later that during the writing process for Tex X, all the writers would meet for breakfast every morning, scarfing down bagels and lox. They would wash down breakfast with heavy doses of coffee, but Pryor would dose his with something extra. Remy Martin, a very good French brandy. Whether that sort of indulgence either helped or hurt Pryor's contributions remains an open question that will probably never be answered. Brooks hired two more writers for the film. One was an attorney named Norman Steinberg, who was an aspiring writer. He had a friend, a dentist named Alan Uger, who was his writing partner. As Brooks admitted in his memoirs, "I just loved the idea of having a comedy writing team that included a lawyer and a dentist. They were just so wrong, they were absolutely right." Brooks hadn't worked with a writing team since your Show of Shows with Sid Caesar. To spur on his writers, and to give them an idea of what he wanted from them, Brooks posted a large sign outside the writer's room, which read, "Please do not write a polite script." On the inside wall, he posted, in large print, "First, we laugh." Years later, Brooks described the writing as, shall we say, chaotic. "Blazing Saddles was more or less written in the middle of a drunken fistfight. There were five of us, all yelling loudly for our ideas to be put into the movie. Not only was I the loudest, but luckily, I also had the right as director to decide what was in or out." In 2016, Andrew Bergman told Brock Swanson of Creative Screenwriting Magazine, "In the beginning, we had five people. One guy left in a couple of weeks. Then it was basically me, Mel, Richie Pryor, and Norman Steinberg. Richie left after the first draft, and then Norman, Mel, and I wrote the next three or four drafts. It was a riot. It was a rioter's room." Brooks said that, while working on the script, there was no subject that he felt was untouchable. If he or the other writers thought of something, no matter how crazy or socially unacceptable, they'd throw it into the mix, because if it came into their minds, it was worth talking about. According to Brooks, "The tone I set for the writing team was the freedom that comes from having nothing to lose. We had absolutely no restrictions on any and all subjects. To further illustrate what it's like to collaborate with Mel Brooks, Steve Haberman, co-screenwriter of Life Stinks, 1991, and Dracula, Dead and Loving It, 1995, was interviewed for this book. Haberman, who has a doctorate in film, has known Brooks for a long time. He told me that he went to the University of Southern California for his cinematic degree, and that he had impressed his professors with a short film he made called Blind Curves. I was fortunate enough to have this professor, Dr. Black, a writing teacher who made an impression on me. He had taught Robert Zemeckis and John Milius and George Lucas and so many others. He liked my work and got me an agent at William Morris when I was still at USC. So I was actually getting screenplays optioned when I was still a student at USC, an undergraduate. I made this movie, Blind Curves, outside of USC, and I put it in a film festival and I won. Somebody saw it, a guy named Don Burns, who I think was a production manager on John Carpenter's Halloween. Anyway, at that time, he was working for New World after Roger Corman left. They were making all these B-movies for drive-ins, which were big in those days. They saw Blind Curves and they liked it. And they had this breakdancing musical called Body Rock, and this very nice guy named Marcello Epstein was supposed to direct it. I think he wrote the script, too. Anyway, he had done music videos, but he'd never done a feature. So they hired me to be a visual consultant, or pictorial consultant, however you want to say it. So my job was to read the script, go on location scouts with him, and break the script down into shots with him and storyboard it. So I did that, and he let me on the set every day. And one day we were doing a big dance number, and it was like guys in skeleton costumes and fog in a studio in Santa Monica. He didn't really have time to finish it. And the DP, director of photography, this guy named Robbie Muller, I don't know how they got him, but he was Wim Wenders' great DP, said, "I don't think we can cover this." And we had to go to LAX, Los Angeles Airport, in the afternoon and catch a plane to go to New York to film the exteriors. The movie was supposed to take place in New York, right? So I said, "I've got an idea. Let's put the camera on a crane and we'll do the rehearsal." Because I had worked with the choreographer to storyboard the dance routine. "We'll run through the dance, and I will block where the crane is going to stop. And everywhere the crane stops, we'll do cross angles that we can cut to, because we probably won't be able to get the whole thing in one crane shot. So let's do that. Let's put it on the crane, see how far we get moving with the dancers, and we'll get the star, Lorenzo Lamas." So we did that. We put the camera on the crane. We did the whole thing, and we got it. And we had time to go back and mark it on the stage and do cross angles. And we'd cut the best parts of the moving crane shots together. We got it in time to uncork champagne before everybody had to get on the bus and go to LAX to fly to New York. The very next day, we were going to start shooting location stuff. The day that I did that, it just so happened that Chuck Russell, who was the executive producer, who went on to direct Mask and A Nightmare on Elm Street 3, was there and saw me do this. Also, the head of New World was there, so they all saw me do this, right? And ever after, when they had a director they didn't feel comfortable with, someone who came from commercials or sitcoms or something besides features, they would hire me to be the visual consultant, basically a job I made up. I ended up working on B-movies like Once Bitten and Return to Horror High. So one day, I got a call from my agent to work on a film called Transylvania 6-5000. The director is a guy named Rudy DeLuca. He's a writer for Mel Brooks, and I get to go to Yugoslavia for this movie with this great cast, including Jeff Goldblum and Ed Begley and Gina Davis and Carol Kane. A big cast. The day I was there, he was auditioning Michael Richards, who later played Kramer on Seinfeld. So Rudy hires me as a consultant, and we go to Yugoslavia, and we make this movie in a real castle in a town outside the village of Zagreb, which has cobblestone streets and Gothic architecture. It's perfect. So we make this movie, and Rudy has no business directing a movie. He couldn't direct anyone to the bathroom. So we come back to the States, and the movie comes out, and it's a hit. I think the budget was like $3 million, and it makes more than $9 million. Rudy's writing partner was Barry Levinson. They'd been writing together for 3 years and had won 2 Emmys for The Carol Burnett Show. They'd co-written Silent Movie and High Anxiety. Barry had gone off to direct Diner, which wasn't a hit, but it was a critical hit. I think he was directing The Natural at the time, with Robert Redford. So Rudy said to me when we came back to the States, "Do you want to be my writing partner?" I said, "Sure. I'm a kid, and this guy had Emmys and had worked with Mel Brooks." So Rudy and I got together and worked on a bunch of stuff. And one day, we're at Rudy's house, and the phone rings. It's Mel Brooks. He had just done Spaceballs. And he asked Rudy, "Do you have anything?" And Rudy said, "No." And Mel said, "Well, I don't have anything either." And I said, "I have something." And so I go into Mel's office at 20th Century Fox, a big office on the corner, Dick Powell's old office on the second floor, and I pitch him this movie. And Mel likes it right away. He likes it. He slaps the table and says, "We'll make it." And so we make Life Stinks. And Mel is very happy with Life Stinks, even though it didn't do very well, because he's got a great part in it, and it's really the only movie he's made since The 12 Chairs that's not a parody. It was actually a movie that he cared about. I figured out that Mel was an auteur. This was news to Mel, but he made movies about people with wild schemes, usually a pair of men. Not that he's gay, he's not, but it's usually two guys who have no business being together, and they team up to do something crazy, and they pull it off. So I thought it would be interesting if a rich guy and a homeless guy did something together. And I thought about it. And I showed Mel movies like Sullivan's Travels and Chaplin movies and stuff like that. And we talked about it being a rich man and a homeless woman. And so we worked on it, and it became Life Stinks. With DeLuca assisting Brooks and Haberman on the screenplay, Life Stinks co-starred Leslie Ann Warren as Molly, the homeless woman who ends up teaching Brooks's character, an empathy-free CEO of a large corporation, about what's really important in life. A more down-to-earth and poignant movie than most of Brooks's films up to that time, Life Stinks was neither a critical nor a box office success, but Haberman and Brooks hit it off as a writing team. "Mel has his writers around every second," Haberman explained, "from pre-production through production through post-production. And when the movie was all done, he said to me, 'You know a lot about movies. I'm not just Mel Brooks. I'm a very classy guy who produced The Elephant Man and The Fly, 84 Charing Cross Road, and a lot of classy movies. And I think you should make a movie for Brooks Films.' So I wrote this science fiction horror movie called Not Human, and Mel bought it, God bless him. And he started to set it up, and we worked on it for a long time, doing storyboards and set designs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.